Is everybody okay with the previous version? Is it working on your laptop? You have the homepage displaying blog post. In these new iterations, maybe what we will do, I will show you a code and I will right away give you the rules, because I will do one more change in the blog class. And when we will have this change, we will be able to build the Dancer 2 plugin. So maybe we want to spend more time on the Dancer 2 plugin itself rather than that. I will show you the code, you will tell me. The main idea of this iteration is to be able to create pagination. We don't want to display all the blog posts on the homepage. We want to display the last M posts and to provide previous and next pages links. To do that, we need to build an index of inside the blog class, the blog class. So I'm going to show you the first change we do. Maybe I will start by the change we do in the Dancer app. First, we will introduce a new attribute, the blog class, which is post per page. The idea is we want to define how many posts we will display on the home page, and we want that to be something that we can change from the settings. So I'm using, you remember at the very beginning we created an entry in the config file named application, and under that I had a new entry post per page, and if it's not provided I outcoded the default value to 5. So in your config file, you should have something like that. Application, published title, you should have post per page. And you can put a very small value for easiness of testing. This way, if you have five posts, you will have paginations. So first, we have this new attribute. I won't show you the code of the blog class now. I just show you what we do now. The home page is a specific case of the pagination. The home page is the first page. So what I do is that I forward the rendering of this route to a new route, which is page slash index of the page. Do you know forward? Mm-hmm. Can you raise your hands, the people who know forward? Okay, half of the audience. And who knows redirect? Little bit more. So,
no, I know auto forward.
Okay, I think still redirect is a little bit more, not that forward. Forward is very specific to Dancer. I think web framework in Perl that does that. It's like an internal redirect. Can I use that?
Yeah,
great. The idea is that you are inside the root that is matching the rest, and you want to delegate the rendering of this root requesting a redirect to the bottom. On the other side, it makes one request. The side is two. We could use redirect here, but what would happen that you hit slash and your browser will be redirected to slash page slash one, which is not very nice. So slash forward here is very good. And now take a look at the page root. Page has a placeholder and we can give that page an index which returns a subset of posts for that page. That's the assumption. Yeah, there is no page. We are going to process. So I want to provide you to space and next page. So we assume that we have another attribute in the blog model which returns the number of pages that are available. And if the current page is lower than the number of total pages, then we can provide a next page link. The same logic for the previous page. And then we can render the whole. And of course, we provide two new values to the home view, next page and previous page. Okay? That's very easy from this point of view, because I'm just using a pagination feature. But if we look at the change we need in the class, it's a little bit more complex. So that's why maybe you don't want to type all that code, maybe it will be a little bit longer. I'm going to show you. So we have a new attribute, post per page. And all the magic happens in a new attribute, which is the index of the blog. So as you can see, the page method is very simple. It takes the page number, defaults to one. We decrement it because we are manipulating an array, so the first element is zero. And we just access that element of the index. Still easy at this point, but if we look at the index itself, it's the more complex part of the code. It's not rocket science, but it's a little bit more complex. What we want to do, we want to create an array of posts. That's the index. So we are, as we did before, we take all the posts, create an index array, and we will proceed each post. And as long as the size of the current page is lower or equal as the number of posts per page, we keep pushing into that array. When it's not the case anymore, we push that array to the main one, and we start over with the remaining posts. Maybe it's easier to read the code than to listen to what I'm saying. The idea is we are grouping posts by slices. And in the end, we have the array of array rows. I'm not Do you want to type it? Double,
yes.
Because we will spend too much time otherwise.
Can I have the US?
Okay, great. I'm just checking the diff to make. Yes, of course, a new method, pages, which is the size of the number of slices we have. And I think that all of this change. Okay, so I prefer the table, and then we will be able to do a plugin.
O que faz aquele menor igual? É um menor igual, então também não fazer mais com aquele.
Tu falas, aparece aqui.
Yes, of course. It will be easier. Yes, I think it's managed to be done. It's okay if you can make it.
This is not a question.
So, I suggest you go there. And you download that part 3 table. And you can start from there. And if someone has no Wi-Fi on the truck, we have the USB keys.
It's the part 3?
Part 3. So before moving on, just making sure it works can be useful. So I'm in part three here.
Stage.
My permalink still works. And if I go back to my home page, I see that I have only two posts on the home page. And on the bottom of the page, I have a link named older entries. Let's take a look at the views, at the layout. We have something new here. At the end of the home view, we have the pagination stuff. And the pagination stuff is using next page and previous page that are provided by the root to create links. So it's quite easy stuff. If we have next page, we provide a link to older articles. And if we have a previous page, to new articles. Let's see what happens when I click on that. As you can see, my home is still the main slash root. I don't see anything new here. And here, I pointed to slash page slash view. And my web server is not running anymore. Then I have a second page with the previous articles. And then I have now two links. Because there are still older articles. And this one is the buggy one, which doesn't have a title, I think. And if I go back here, I go back to the root. So it works fine. Do you have this working version on your laptop, yeah, thanks to the Tarball? Everyone is ready?
Okay.
No.
No. Almost. Okay. I wait a little bit then.
É um parte 2, parte
3. Vou começar a usar. Vou usar. Aqui dentro, quando a ver, está a ver erros.
Just Do you remember when we first created the blob object in the Dancer app, we said that there was something wrong? The fact that when we create new posts, they won't show up until we restart the app. Remember that? Okay. We will now try to fix that, but without recreating again and again the same object. And to do that, we will use a cache system, a caching system. There is a very good caching distribution on CPAN. Probably know it. It's CHI. You know it, CHI, no? It's a very good interface for caching. Maybe we can just have a look first. Where is my mouse? It's a very good one. If you need to cache stuff, I really recommend it. It's like DBI for caching, if you like. If you can read, you can see that basically you will have a common interface, whatever the backend of the cache is. You can provide drivers to CHI. And you have lots of stuff for rules for expiring entries in the cache and many nice things. And the API is quite nice to play with. So the idea we want to cache our blog object. So it can expire at some point and needs to be refreshed. And to do that, we want to use CHI. But on the other hand, we don't want create specific cache code inside the app itself. And we want to do that in the plugin. So we look how to do that. The first thing we will do, actually, I will show you first how I'd like to use it. So I will again start by the code. I still okay. So the first step is that. The first step is we have a cache plugin. Page. Which cache page we and won't need a rendering if there is already content. And the usage is very simple. We want to be able to create root response like that. Instead of calling template directly, template, we call cache page template. The main idea is that we are going to look if we already have a response for the request path in the cache system. If it's the case, we're going to return the value we had, and if we don't, we will execute that and store the content in the cache. And when we will have that working, we will be able to extend that to a generic cache keyword, and we will cache the blog object itself. So let's look at that plugin. So, of course, we use CHI because we are going to use it to build the cache node. And here you see Dancer 2 plugin, which allows us to create a Dancer 2 plugin. What a plugin is. Quick question, how many of you have written a plugin for Dancer 1? Okay, so a plugin, it's completely new for all of you.
Yes.
Sort of. Okay, so that's interesting. It's basically the same well, if you want to look at differences between Dancer 1 and Dancer 2, plugins are the main differences. Because of the internal design of Dancer 2, which is based entirely on Moo, everything in Dancer 2 is an object, and it provides a better encapsulation of the code. And for that reason, writing a plugin with Dancer 2 is a little bit more object-oriented. You don't really think about strings. So the idea we have here, so the first time, it will be a private variable in that plugin. We are using memory backend, which means that this cache will live in the process memory of the worker. And we say that everything we put in the cache will be kept for 10 minutes maximum. At this point, we are only using it to cache the log. It will be able to refresh the home page every 10 minutes without more than that. And you can see on plugin import. So that provided by Dancer 2 plugin. And you will see that all the block code you will have in the plugin will out like that. I thought PSN was shift. The first argument that is asked to this kind of code blocks is the DSN. And what is the DSN object? Do you know what DSN stands for? Domain specific language, okay? Basically a set of keywords for doing things. Dancer is basically a DSN. Dancer is a mini language for writing web application. Dancer 2 actually class which composes a role, which is a DSN, and which is all the words that for instance, we are actually using the method get of the DSL of DSL. When you are writing a plugin, what you are doing is creating new keywords. So that's the best code for installation. And you receive the current DSL object of the calling app. So whatever you want to do to enter the calling app, you need to do it against that object. For instance, in this case, we want to catch calls to and to look if there is something in the cache or not. So we want to create a hook. How many of you have used hooks in Dancer? One. Okay, almost half of the objects. So, just a quick word about hooks. In Dancer 2, you have a request flow when the developer requests something on the Dancer app. Dancer will over many steps to find the response. And in many places, there are some kind of breakpoints where hooks can be called. For instance, the hook before is meant to be called just before the rules. So whenever you define a hook in the before hook, the code you attach to it will be executed before the matching rules. And you can alter the response. What we do is, when the plugin is loaded, that who does the following. First, we get the path of the current request. The current request is easy. It's provided by the path info of the request keyword dancer. And as we are in the plugin, the request keyword is called on the DSL object. Are you following me? Okay. So here we have the requested path. For instance, if I asked for slash hello world, in dollar pass, I will have slash hello world. Then I look in my cache object. If I have something for slash hello world, I will use the pass as the key of the cache. So I use on my CHI object get slash pass. The hook, and as it didn't change anything in the request flow, the hook will be called. But if we have a comment, then we have a little debug line, so we won't. Whenever you use that sort of package, the application object is created. And that sort of core is created. And you can access the object, the app, and you have to let. The current context of the request. You have the calling request, you have the response that is going to be built, and you have, for instance, access to sessions and stuff like that. To alter the response, we can access the response here, because that's the response, the newborn response, the one that will be created. And as you can see here, we set the content of the current response to the content we found in the cache. And then we trigger the heart. The keyword add, as in dancer one, tells the dispatcher to stop and to render the current response as it is. Okay? Get the idea. So this is the before hook. Do you think we have everything in here to provide caching for rendering all the pages? Or do you think something is missing?
Content type?
The content type.
Okay. Cannot cache non-text HTML.
Exactly. That's a good remark.
The last number five.
Yes, all the headers are not cached. So that's a bug. That's a bug.
Here you're just checking if you have something on cache. Positive. You're not putting
exactly. Exactly. So how can we put stuff in the cache? With the new keyword. Cache page. Remember before we changed, instead of using just templates, we did cache page template something. And that's where we are going to cache content. So, for those of you who have already done a plugin with Dancer One, you should already know register. Register, it's the same with Dancer One, is here to provide you a handler to create a new keyword. Syntax is simple. Register the name of the keyword and the subroutine attached to it. Whenever someone will use your plugin, that keyword will be exported to the DSL. So if I use this plugin, the next line, I'm able to use cache page. And again, the first argument is the DSL object. That's specific to DensFactory. And we define here an interface. We say that we will take a content and an options array. So I don't know why I've put that. It's not defined DSL. I don't know. Maybe I had a very good name.
Because in
that
certain point, I
have to
give DSL
some constraints. Yes, that should be that. okay, so we want to have the namespace. So we will do the same as in the previous one. The namespace, or if you like, the key of the cache is the request path info. So it's the same as before, DSS request path info. Then a little logging line to tell log that I am caching something now. And easily, I set in the namespace the content, and I expand the and that's it. That should do the job. Okay. Do you have everything? Or if you like, at the end, I will do also a towel, so it's as you prefer. So we can test it. So just a refresh, a little refresh on the code. We use the plugin here. I forgot also to tell you that in the end of the plugin, we need to end with register plugin. It will register everything in DensFactory. Okay, so if you look at the get page, now it does cache page template. And permalink, the same. So if I summarize, whenever I send a request to the application, the before hook catch the request, look in the cache if we have something for the matching request. If we do, it returns the catch value and stops. So nothing is done more. And if it's not, it does nothing. Then the workflow continues with the current matching route. And as all the routes that produce content use cache page, they will write to the cache the content that they've produced. Let's see if it works. Okay, so I have something here. And what about my logs? Caching page one. Makes sense. Because that's the very first time I've copied. My cache is in memory, so it was empty. The before filter didn't find anything. The root got rendered. And my plugin told me that it was caching something. You can see that it's the plugin that is logging something, right? Well, you can't see it. Between, we don't see it. And what happens if I hit the same page again? Still works. And then I have a different line of log. Got a cache for page one. And this time you see it's a hook that is logging stuff. So it looks to work well. If I access another page, for instance, all the articles, I have a different content. And then a new cache stuff. If I refresh it, I got a cache as well. So it looks to work. Got the cache. And what about permalink? Yes, permalink works as well. Okay. So, should I create a new table for this step? Yes?
Que qual a diferença do plugin?
O chefe de plugins
é existente, é o facto de ter aqui uma das confusões
e cada vez já tem.
Precisas de fazer use case. Não, e repara, tu tens aqui esta função. Tu não estás só a definir esta função, tu estás a definir esta função. Mas esta função é uma função que você vai chamar passando já estas coisas. Quando vai chamar uma fase de cache, qualquer coisa, pode ter uma função para passar esta cena. O cache já passa por tudo.
So you have the platform online. So when you have it, you should be able to run the blog and have caching working. Yes. If someone doesn't have access to the network, there is a little USB key here. It's very good when you write your own tensor application to recognize parts where you could create a plugin, even for yourself. It's also a good way to tolerate different kinds of logic in good places. For instance, here, caching content has nothing to do with the blog itself, and it has also nothing to do with your web layer. So it's just enhancing the way Tensor is a tool for you. So it's clearly a good way to do it as a plugin. Actually, you will find on CPAN a Tensor plugin cache or Tensor plugin CHI that exists, but I wanted to create a little one with you. I think it's more interesting for the training than using a working plugin. Also, you've seen that we have created a book, a before book, that you can create as many books as you like in a plugin. Working for everyone? So let's go to the next step. Just checking and forgetting the slide. So we want to cache the blog object. But basically, what we want is a way of caching anything. In this first version of the plugin, we created a cache page keyword, which is specific to caching something related to a request. You remember, the namespace of the cache is the matching request path. And that's not very generic. In our case now, we want to cache an object, an arbitrary object. It's not related to a request. So we want to have something more generic. So what we will do, we will refactor the cache plugin to add a new keyword named cache, which will take a namespace and a content. So, and the first thing we change, so here for debugging purpose, you can set a lower expiration time. This way. So I will use only 1 minute. This way I will be able to test easily when I create a new post. Less than 1 minute I should see them on the page. So that's a minor change. Plugin import the same. We have a new keyword, cache, and it's very easy. Do you know this little trick when you create accessors? When you create a function that is supposed either to set value to a key or to return the value of that key, it's good to do this way. You test the size of arguments the function is passed, instead of testing if value is defined. This way I can set to undef a value. Okay, so here I'm using this little trick. I have a namespace and an object. If the object is given, then I'm doing a set in my cache object. Else, I'm doing a get. It's really, really, really So that's easy stuff. So you can type it. I need a table for that. Thank you. Okay. So let's use that. Can I keep the loop? So we want to use that to cache blob object. So you should have a dollar blob object at the top of your file, and we will change that with a sub. And this, that sub will contain all of the logic of finding the blob object either from the cache or creating it for the first time. And as we use the cache system backend, that first line will return a defined value only when the cache is still existing. So if we have something, we return it and it's done. If we don't, we create it and we cache it, and we can return it afterwards. And of course, wherever you are using $blog, you need to use blog instead. Like for instance on this slide. And the trick is done. Basically, you should have three instances where blog is called form. Blog page here, and that's it. Okay. When you have that, you can restart your app and you can do a little test. So still work, okay. Can click. Grab a link. Good. And I'm going to create a new post. I suggest you do the same on your version. and the app was not stopped. And as my cache lifetime is only 1 minute, the index got refreshed. It should work the same on your side. Is it working for everyone? Maybe you can do a little checkup with it. Yes?
No?
Do you want some help? Post is not.
Fez a função do objeto do bloco, né? Do currículo, portanto, da frase humana. E o subject log tem uma cena page ou é um post?
If you don't use the cache, you will render up page
data.
See if you use
off
course. Yes, but you will need to pass the
line. Flat.
Using this technique is a good because you keep stuff in memory, still have some refresh times. And you don't use the file system IOs.
Okay,
anyone
is there
on
working line? Não, esse page é um page do object log, que é um blog que você pode montar para você.
Mas é muito curioso. Estava agora a ver a apresentação de fazer post. Eu ia falar com o Initializer, já vi o que é. Initializer, Bootstrap, Bootstrap, e este já usa o Paysol. O Paysol vai modificar o Bootstrap. Só porque, por exemplo, no Paysol, o que faz isto? No Paysol, o que é o Bootstrap?
Eu não tenho um nome.
Não, 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 não,
Thank you.
In a way, yes, because at some point, what the last steps in the catch expires, and then the planet expires. Yes, this one is a reform catches and looks if it has a contact with the cache for the restaurant that's in the back. If it has, if it doesn't, if you have anything, it doesn't exist. Then, you press the start. That's what I will find.
Pretty much.
You are requesting swaps? Before, yes, it's that part. Because your program is requesting five codes. One is for five and one is for and as you put a log line by default, if you want to see it, you can request the row classically. And instead of using print as the year, you can do the same. just use the request pass info in the
this is
it's part of it. It's the way we don't render again the same content. If that content already exists in the cache, we use it. We never this one is only for caching response of requests. You can remove that. And the index, the work, but that is only for cache phasing. If you want to refresh the content, you need the cache that contains the flow and check the file. It's something that is not in the cache.
É bem normal quando tens cenas para uma própria dependência na prática de tudo. Imagina, logo uma cena, vem para o caso de dados, depois todas as coisas que quiserem é tudo aquilo, ou metes para ser a base de dados. Criar plugins, seja para o software, para o web, para o Windows, criar um plugin para o depois agora se quiser criar plugins,
quer mais ou menos o que that's the main blog, which contains if we have to save them, it's not really fair. So, we don't have it in the cache, we can create it and save it. So, it's a little bit.
So now everyone has a working bug engine with a cache system. And we create a download for our website. And so here, I just removed the new post, and you can see that it got removed also. And now create a tabor.
Two times request is the right thing to do the 12 words.
Is what?
12 words.
Ah, yes. It's logic. So, if you need, we have the part 5 and 9.
Yeah. So,
maybe you've, when you've tested your app, you've experienced some errors with one of the posts which didn't have a post body entry.
Mm-hmm.
The second post.
Yes.
So this bug is fixed
now.
Where is my? So, if you want to look, it was just here. For instance, in title, it's protected with an eval log. So it's a little detail, but if you want to protect the code, and the idea is that it's not a big deal if there is a malformed post, and we will just return an empty string. So that's what is done here. Everyone knows about catching exceptions like that. Of course, there is a best way to do that with try tiny or other exception modules, but that's an easy way to do it. So in this case, it's good enough. And if there is an exception, it will be defined in this $@dialogue, and that's the way we can protect it. We did the same also for the body. Okay, so just a little thing. Now we are going to use another technique. If you look at your version, you don't have that. It's not as nice as that on your version. Right? Can you check? You should have just a date with an arrow and a time.
No.
Yes? So we are going to look at how we can do that. Nice. Quick CPAN question. Do you have an idea of a module that can build a nice phrase like that from a time object?
STRF time.
STRF time, we would need to do a lot of stuff because here it's rounded, you know? It's published 1 hour and 20 minutes ago. It doesn't mess with seconds. And no one knows a module that does that.
That's the duration fuzzy?
Yes, it's not fuzzy, but it's time duration. It's time duration. So the idea here, and that would be the last iteration of this blog engine. Afterwards, if you like, we will be able to go in the code of TensorTube if you want me to explain some part or some part of the design. I would be happy to do that. Or also, if you have questions, maybe we will be able to conclude the training with questions. But for this last iteration, it's better that time streaming. So the first thing we want to do. Is we want to add that replication that date in the object. It's quite easy. So thank you. So we use time duration. And we we do a little refactoring, we create a new attribute, publication dat time, who holds the dat time object. And this allows us to create publication ago. Ago is a function provided by time duration. From the current time, and we get the timestamp, the number of seconds that represent the time since article was written, and it provides that to a group, and it creates this nice string of hours and minutes ago. Okay. The main idea of this refactoring was to have one dead time object and to use it for the publication date and to provide a new attribute. And when we have that in the model, of course, we change the view. We use it. Is it working fine for everyone? The end of what? That's the main part. We have the dead time object here, created from the timestamp of the creation file, the file created at timestamp of the file. We kept original attribute publication date as it was, but using publication DT object instead of. If in the previous version, these two stuff were merged. And it allows us to use it here. time duration.
The definition of those contacts.
It's here. We don't want to store replication because it changes every second. Because that's a good question. The question was, why don't we create an attribute for that? Do you have an idea? For publication ago, the question was, yes, exactly. We are using time to create this value. So time is the number of seconds since 1st January 1970. So every second, it will change. If we create a has, if we create an attribute, you will store the value in the object. So we don't want to store it. So that's really a method. It depends on the current time.
But it's using
the function. The function is used in the volume. Well, if you want, I can show it again. We have the post in cache for the lifetime of the cache. Yes. But if you remember, it does a string only with the units. So it's a fuzzy language, it's okay. Even though it said the blog post was 2 minutes ago, but it's not a big deal. So the question is, where do we use it? And it's here. You see, in the view, published, p.publication ago. And p is a post object. So publication ago, we call the subroutine that is defined in the post class. That's where it's called.
Feito com a
O valor do dado do poder de publication é bom.
Certo.
Acho que não, acho que vai buscar isso com duas sets. Uma coisa,
quando o bloco contém totalmente. Vamos usar aqui.
Na prática não vai fazer diferença. Uma publication é igual.
Muito um freio.
Uma publication é igual. Acho que funciona, não vai fazer diferença.
So, the last version here is online. So, is it working for everyone? If it's not, tell me, because that was the last part of the block engine. The last part, as it is now.
Todas as funções que são definidas, vais ter que escolher para saber qual é o valor delas e poder mudar. Sim. Imagina que eu ganhei o sleep 3 horas. Ficava mal, eu estava deixando a golpe.
At this point, we have a working blog engine with all the main features. We will do a coffee break now. If it doesn't work on your laptop, you can tell me and I can help you. And otherwise, have a nice break. And we see you again afterwards.
Temos objetos todos e cada objeto, em vez de ter ser uma acha, não sei o que, um objeto é só uma suficiência para a cena nessa acha global.
Right.
That you part the part to use move.
Yeah.
So what about now that we might be at the move series? Thinking about migrating you to the threads as well.
Yeah, of course. The main change, yeah. It's more the fact that everything and it really changed a lot of
things. Yeah,
it's really more that's why it was at first, I wanted to patch it's very easy, but that's, I think now it's the main stuff to do is to migrate the system, and also the plugin system needs again some but we managed to have now
Okay.
So, this one is built when you came out for the question.
The object does this thing. Yes.
I was hoping that the coffee bag was for pets. Sorry.
2 minutes.
Yes, that's Stefan minutes. It looks like my Wi-Fi connection is weak.
Yeah.
So maybe I won't be able to.